Okay, sorry. It is Dr. Kalsiwal Award, and our speaker is Dr. Uma Sharma. Dr. Uma Sharma is currently working as assistant professor at AIIMS, New Delhi. She is PhD MSc in Biomedical Sciences from IIT Roorkee, and she has many papers to her credit. Dr. Uma.
A very good morning to everyone. I would like to thank National Academy of Medical Sciences. I am really deeply honored to receive this Dr. R.M. Kalsiwal Award on my paper, Metabolomic Similarity in Macroscopically Normal Appearing and Abnormal Colonic Mucosa in Patients with Inflammatory Bowel Diseases. We have selected two common IBDs. These are ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease. These diseases affect small intestine and colon. And you could see that how the ulcerations are seen in ulcerative colitis. These are the endoscopic images. Here the ulcerations are superficial, and these are limited to the inner lining of the mucosa, while in CD the ulcerations are deep. And if you look at the normal mucosa in controls, it appears like this, and similar to this, almost uninvolved mucosa in patients with Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis appears. So why we were interested in these diseases is that differentiation using histology, endoscopy and various clinical features, it is difficult in 15% of cases. And the second point which I want to highlight is that disease progresses to normal area, and the greater spread of disease is seen on histology than on colonoscopy. And point that also which I want to highlight is that there is similar macroscopic appearance of normal colonic mucosa, which is uninvolved in IBD patients and controls. So we were interested in finding out whether we can find out any method to differentiate between these two diseases and find out the mechanism of disease progression, how it is progressing to the normal area, whether we can find out any factors related to that. So these were the objectives of the study. To study the metabolomics of involved colonic mucosa of patients with ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease and controls using in vitro proton NMR spectroscopy to determine biomarkers for differentiation of the diseases. And then we have studied the metabolomics of uninvolved colonic mucosa in UC and CD to get an insight into mechanism of progression of the disease. Why we have chosen metabolomics? Metabolomics is basically the study of metabolism. And if you look at it, it is a newly born cousin, can be said, of genomics and transcriptomics and proteomics. And the information that comes from genome to transcriptome and proteome, that is reflected in metabolome. And metabolome consists of sugars, nucleotides, amino acids, lipids. And these metabolomics basically represent the phenotype and function. And not only the genomic information is presented in metabolome, even the environmental influences and the dietary influences can be studied using metabolomics. So this gives us the complete picture. The techniques that can be used are listed here. We have used NMR technique. And there is a flexibility that you can use any kind of tissue, any kind of specimen listed here. And these metabolites serve as direct signatures of biochemical activity and are much easier to correlate with the phenotype. This is the experimental procedure. These many patients we have enrolled. These were the control subjects with the obscure gastrointestinal bleeding and colonic polyps, where the colon appears normal. We have taken 10 biopsies from abnormal and normal regions from a patient and control who were undergoing colonoscopy. And from these biopsies, using perchloric acid extraction procedure, metabolites were extracted. And then NMR was performed and data was analyzed using univariate analysis and the multivariate analysis methods. This is the NMR spectrum. You may see that this is the scale, and here these are the intensities of the metabolites. Each of the line was assigned to a particular metabolite, and these intensities correspond to the concentration of the metabolites present in that tissues or that tissue or that biofluid. And using these intensities, we can find out the concentration of these metabolites. This is from control, this is from ulcerative colitis, and this is from constipation. You may see that some pattern is visible. These metabolites appear to be lower in levels in ulcerative colitis and Crohn's diseases. We will be seeing it later. This is the spectrum from the uninvolved area and the involved area from the Crohn's disease. The spectral pattern can be seen here. So these are the quantitative results. We compared the concentration of metabolites in the controls and patients with UC and patients with CD, and this is from the involved area. You may see that the concentrations of several metabolites like isoleucine, leucine, lactate, alanine, arginine, glutamate, and these are significantly lowered in the patients of IBD disease, while the concentration of glucose, that is significantly higher in IBD patients. And it may be seen that format is the one which is different in the patients of UC and CD, which has the probability of using as a biomarker. When we carried out PLS-DA analysis, that is multivariate analysis, this is a pattern recognition approach, using which we have built a statistical model, and we can see, we can categorize the patients, we can see visually whether the patients are different from the controls or there is a difference in the diseases. So you can see this plot represents the samples. The samples from the ulcerative colitis patients, they appear in different quadrants, and the patients from and the samples from control samples, which are in blue, they appear in a different quadrant and they form a different cluster. So using these models, we can later classify the other samples, whether they belong to UC or whether they belong to CD or whether they belong to control category. So similarly, this is the plot for control and CD. So here also you can see that they are clustered in a separate groups. Then we compare the uninvolved colonic mucosa from IBD patients with the controls, and we could see that there is significant lowering of several metabolites in the uninvolved colonic mucosa compared to the controls. And these are alanine, glutamate, glutanine, and many other metabolites. So then we compared the concentration of these metabolites among the three groups: controls, IBD, IBD uninvolved mucosa, and IBD involved mucosa. So here you can see the uninvolved area is similar to the involved area, and all the metabolites, they are different from the control metabolites. Lactate is highly raised in controls, while it is lower in IBD involved and involved area, indicating that the metabolic profile of involved area and uninvolved area is similar. And when we plotted the multivariate analysis plot, we could find out that involved and uninvolved area formed a separate cluster than the control area, and they form a same cluster. They are all in same cluster, while the controls are in a different cluster. So what is next? We have to find out what are the reasons for this this metabolic similarity, how it has appeared, and what could be its implications. So if we correlate the levels of these metabolites, this lactate is the product of glycolysis, while glucose is the substrate. And glucose is high in our study and lactate is lower. So that means there is inability to utilize glucose for energy. And it has been observed that malnutrition and starvation are the features of IBD. And in the feces of patients of IBD, there has been observed increase of lactate metabolites. When we looked at the amino acid metabolism, we could find out that these metabolites, glutamate, glutamine, and alanine, were lower in both uninvolved and involved area of patients with IBD. What does this mean? The 30% of the total energy that is derived by mucosa is through the conversion of glutamine and alanine. And this is very important process. And this is not only the catabolic process that is important, These amide groups derived in this process, these are used for synthesis of hexosamines, which are the components of membrane glycoproteins and amino acids. So, because this pathway is affected, so this may affect the mucosal membrane integrity. And glutamine is not only involved in this process, it maintains the secretory IgA levels. So when we look at the fatty acid metabolism, we could find out that there is a lower concentration of formate in both involved and uninvolved area of IBD patients. And these short-chain fatty acids, these are produced in colon by the fermentation of unabsorbed carbohydrates by gut microbiota in colonic lumen. So, and these provide a large amount of energy, about 70% to colonic mucosa. So that means the colonic mucosa is energy deficient in both involved and uninvolved, in both uninvolved and involved area. And there is decreased, and this also affects this formate. This also affects the sodium potassium pump, and this may lead to diarrhea if it is not proper. Then we looked at the membrane metabolites. We have seen that there is a lower concentration of membrane metabolites like GPC and choline and myonestrol in both uninvolved and non-involved area. And we could see that these are the essential components of membrane synthesis, and their deficiency may lead to anomalous membrane synthesis and may affect membrane integrity. So what could be its implications? As I have already stated, that these mucosa, whether it is uninvolved or whether it is involved, it is metabolically deficient, and that means that abnormal metabolic activity is progressed to the normal area also, and the metabolically both abnormal and both involved and uninvolved mucosa are similar. As we are aware that colonocytes perform various functions like electrolyte exchange, mucin synthesis, lipid synthesis, structural protein synthesis, and detoxification. And these all processes are energy dependent processes, and these are vital to health. And if these functions are affected because of energy deficiency, this may lead to the condition that even the normal appear area will not be able to repair the mucosa, and this may hamper the repair mechanism. And this could be, we thought that this could be the reason for disease progression in IBD. So these are the conclusions of the study. These are the metabolites which were different, and we have observed that the uninvolved area of colonic mucosa also has reduced activity, and which is similar to abnormal colonic mucosa. And this indicates energy deficiency of colonic mucosa, and this deficiency may hamper repair mechanism and may contribute to the disease progression in IBD. Thank you all for your attention. I would like to acknowledge National Academy of Medical Sciences for giving me this award, and my collaborators, Professor N.R. Jagannathan, who is HOD of our department, Professor Govind K. Makharia, who is a gastroenterologist, Professor Vinita Ahuja, gastroenterologist, and Dr. Rajiv Varsi. Thank you. Yes. Yeah, yes.
Because these are all inflammatory conditions.
Yes,
which
sir.
Affect the field rather than the lesion itself. So
uh-huh.
In that sense, there is nothing unusual about it. Is just a stochastic process that one place gets a lesion when the whole field is affected. So in a way, that is what you would, even all therapy is all systemic rather than lesional. So that's one possibility that you could, you know, consider. The other issue is that, is it possible to do any oxidative stress markers by MR spectroscopy? Those are emerging damaging agents.
We could estimate, sir, metabolites like glutathione and all, which are related to stress. So, which we have not estimated in this study. Maybe we will look for that.
other questions? Diligently suffer. But it was a bit surprising as to why the spectra of lactate was less, particularly once you were dealing with the anaerobic metabolism in most of the inflammatory conditions. You showed it quite less in comparison to the their normal group.
It was lesser in that one, so that means they are not able to utilize glucose properly.
You have explained, but that explanation probably you will have to probably postulate something else for it.
Mm-hmm.
Just a comment.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Good morning, ma'am. My question to you is, by that uninvolved area was having low metabolism, although that area was not involved. So I just need that.
To me, it appears that the like whatever we observed on endoscopy, that it appears normal there, but metabolically it is not normal. So it is energy deficient.
Ma'am, but if an area is energy deficient, so that area, if ATP is less, then membrane integrity will be lost, so and so. That will lead to ulceration after some time. Or.
Yeah.
So, ma'am, if that area is now energy deficient, that will be, that will lose its integrity afterwards only.
Yeah.
It will lead. So, ma'am, why it is so that it is, at present it is uninvolved, it is seeming to be uninvolved, and later on it is seeming involved.
Yeah, this is what it is, that whatever morphologically we are seeing, that is evident biochemically much earlier. So biochemically you can see the differences much earlier compared to the morphological.
So ma'am, if you go to electron microscopy and you will see that the structure of the cell, and you will see the mitochondria, and so you would be able to appreciate the differences there also in the mitochondrial level or at the level of the membrane.
I have not done that kind of a study. Maybe, if somebody looks at that, maybe those can be, we have to see like whether it appears there or not.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sharma. On behalf of the National Academy of Medical Sciences, I request you to kindly come forward to receive the Dr. R. M. Kastlingamal Award.